Olivetti Company in Ivrea. Olivetti was, as you probably know, the most important electronic Italian company in the 60s, was who produced a lot of writer machines, and then after start in the world of computer, and for political reason they lost they closed the part of computer and continue to produce mechanical writing machine, and of course after 10 years they completely lose the company because all the world was changed in relation of computers. Actually, this was their first personal computer. But the important thing here is in the location of the Olivetti's company, Telecom Italia found a school called Interaction Institute of Ivrea in 2003, more or less. And in this school was involved Massimo Vanzi, which is the most famous, let's say, Arduino's guy. And these three guys here was professors. This was a doctoral student. And this is the guy who produced Arduino in Italy. Then the idea, as this school was made for designers and artists, the idea was to create a platform very easy to use. Then, as I said before, Arduino is not the first microcontroller, it's not the most performant, it's not the cheapest. It's the first who considered the microcontroller as a teaching tool, a teaching instrument. Then they produce this first prototypes here for the students of the school. Then when the school decide to close because Telecom don't give more money to pay the school, they take the decision to make it open source, in order to continue to use after the closure of the school. Then this was quite a revolution in the interaction field, because something very easy to use was open for everybody, and people could have all the information to reproduce Arduino, from the hardware to the software. And then, as you know now, Arduino is the most diffused platform for physical computing. Then physical computing, it's the communication in between physical world and computing world. Then how to sense and control the environment through a computer. This is a very funny image from this old book, in which you can see here how the transducers, which are sensors and actuators, can sense the world, give the information to microcontrollers, and the microcontrollers give back the command to actuate in the world through the transducer. Then, when we talk about transducers, we talk about sensors or actuators, which are electronic components able to sense and collect information from the real world, convert it in digital information, and the same back. Then, for example, if we talk about light sensor is a photoresistor. It's an electronic component who react to the light, changing the resistance to the current. Then this you can measure the difference of resistance in these two poles, in these two wires, So in this wire, this is the data, and measuring this change of resistance, you can recognize how much light there are in the ambient. Okay, then this is a transducer, and this, for example, is a resistive force sensor. And then, depending of the quantity of the force you apply to this sensor, you will receive a change of the voltage in the wire. Those are examples of sensors, and a very common example of actuator is a servo motor. Then after we will see what happened inside of this motor, but if we talk about a normal motor, let's say, could be a transducer for input or a transducer for output. It means if I give current to a motor, the motor will convert, transduce the electricity in movement. Okay, transducer are devices that can change from one form, one type of energy in another type of energy, then from electricity to movement. And at the same time, if I take a motor and I turn very fast, I can generate electricity, okay, because it's a transducer, and I can transform mechanical movement in electricity. I know that for some of you, the things I'm saying are very basic, but the idea is for people who never use a motor, people from mainly from industrial design or design in general, or maybe also from computer science, maybe you never use a motor. Okay, what happens in a motor is when you apply energy for an electromagnetic field, you generate a movement. And sometimes if you move the axis of a motor very fast, you can generate electricity from the other side. Then, this is a microcontroller. In this case, will be Arduino. And the microcontroller could be connected by wire or wireless to a computer in order to upload the list of instructions, which is the firmware, the list of instructions, in order to allow the microcontroller to decide what happens if some data arrive from the input. Okay? Then, in other words, we will have something like a transducer from the physical world to the computing world, with that, for example, analog to digital converter. Then, for example, a sensor could sense 20 degrees of temperature, and will be a conversion to computing side to allow the microcontroller to take decisions. Okay, this is the new version of the original book of Tom Igo. It's very interesting. If you can take a look, it's very useful. This book here is very useful also for designers, because talk about in a very easy way about all the problematic related with making things move, then friction and torque, these kind of things. Then this is the actual say version of Arduino, more or less, and this is the team of Arduino, and this is a part of the evolution tree of Arduino. The important thing here is since the 2005 there was a lot of different versions of Arduino, and for example here you can see the an Arduino Mega. This is not an Arduino, but there are Arduinos like this, Arduino Mini or Nano. There are a lot of versions of Arduino. We continue to use the Arduino Uno just because it's the easiest to use for didactical scope, because you can plug and unplug wires without soldering or something or other kind of problem. Then we normally use Arduino Uno just because it's the easiest to teach. But of course you don't need to use it if you want. Normally you can start to develop with Arduino Uno, and after, if you need to reduce dimension or if you need to connect a lot of things, you change to another platform. Or for example, you can use the Arduinos. The last version have included the Wi-Fi or the Bluetooth capability in order to communicate in wireless. In this model here, you need the wire to communicate with the computer and to upload the firmware. This is just to show you how the family of Arduino increased during the time. And considering also that Arduino is an open source hardware, you can find a lot of versions of pseudo Arduino for many different producers and providers. Someone asked me why we buy the original one, because of course there are a lot of producers, cheaper than Arduino original, but we, at least I take for me, I buy Arduino original just because it's a way to thanks people who develop this and give the possibility to a lot of people to work in this field. But normally you can use a clone of Arduino, it's what, more or less the same. You can see here two different versions of the microcontroller ATmega, and one is the pass-through technology. It's been with the legs like this, and the other one is the SMD edition with this kind of chip, which is soldered in the surface. Was, let's say, a normal evolution, because produce this is cheaper than produce this. But at the end, they back to this version, because this version here is, for us, the most, diffused in academic field, because if you born your Arduino, which is quite difficult, but could happen, you can take out physically the microcontroller and change with another microcontroller for €5 and instead of pay €22 for the interior platform. But in any case, are exactly the same. It's just a different format of microcontroller or of microchip, but it's the same. Then, as I told before, Arduino Uno do not have the possibility to communicate wireless. Then, in order to upload your firmware, you need to use a cable, USB cable, and connect your computer and upload the firmware. The firmware will be right. Could be right. We normally use the idea of Arduino, which is software to develop to write the instruction, which is called also Arduino. Then Arduino is the hardware, is the software, but the most important part of Arduino is the community. There's a lot of people all around the world working in Arduino. Then this is why I advised you to find for project, you can solve for sure your problem, because somebody before you have the same problem. Then if you need to solve some problem with Arduino, you can surely find the solution online. Then Arduino Uno has two lines of pins. These are female pins, and the object, the goal of this is to allow to plug a male pin. Then, as we said before, this is a converter, let's say, in between physical world and digital world. Then you here can plug sensors and actuators, then transducers. Arduino will read these sensors, compute and decide what to do, and then write from these pins to give the information to control the actuators. You have two types, we will see after, but you have two types of data that can arrive to Arduino, which are analog data or digital data. The analog data will be plugged here, for example, this light sensor will give us analog data, which means a range of data from 0 till 1023. It's a range of data. And the other side, you have digital data, which is high or low, open or closed, energy or not energy, switch on, switch off. Then here you can use to connect sensors to read information from the world in another way. And the other side you can use, those pins here for read information from the environment, or to give information to the environment through transducers. In this case, you should set up those pins, telling if you will use this pin specifically, I don't know, the pin number 5 as input or output. We will see after. Then, pins input-output, pins only input, and pins for power. You can find here power plus and minus, and VIN and 5 volts, 3.3 volt, and reset. Okay, reset is this button here. We will see after in the code what happened, but reset is for switch off and switch on again the Arduino. And you can do the same through this pin. If you send an impulse in this pin, the Arduino will reset and start again. Then another important thing is, in order to give power, to give energy to Arduino, you can use three different ways. One is through the USB wire. During uploading your firmware, you are giving also 5 volts from your computer to Arduino through this wire. But you can also use this jack here, which is a normal jack for for example, and then you can use the wire to upload the firmware. Then after you unplug the Arduino, will switch off because of not energy, but the firmware is already inside. Then after you can plug this one with a battery, and the Arduino will continue to work as before. And then you can use here the jack. Or you can use here a pin directly using V in, voltage in. It's the same. And you can have, I don't know, a battery and plug and plug in this wire, in this pin, 5 volt or until 12 volt. Actually, Arduino has a voltage regulator inside, and then you can use from 5 volt till 20 volt, and Arduino will use just 5 volt, which is the normal voltage, working voltage. It's better don't use more than 12 volt, because in order to consume the difference in between this 8 volt, normally the Arduino heat become warm, and then it's better to use until 12 volt. Then another important thing is the LED inside in the board that are very useful as feedback. There is one LED here directly connected to pin number 13, and it's commonly used for debugging. We will see after. The very important LED here, the on LED, which is important to understand if, for example, you are doing some mistake in the electronic circuit, because if you plug your Arduino and this LED here start to blink, there is probably some short circuit in your electronic circuit. Then pay attention about this. And these two pins here show us when there are some serial communication between Arduino and the computer. Then when you plug your Arduino to the computer and upload the firmware, you will see these two LEDs that continue to blink, because it's writing and reading from the serial port to the computer. Okay, then about the IDE, the software. Do you already install the IDE? Yes? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then, normally you don't need, it's very easy to install in setup. The only thing is control that the board is the board that you effectively are using, because if you are using the Arduino Uno, you should take this, and the other is Arduino Mega, depending of what kind of board are you using, you need to set up. And the other thing is the serial port. Normally for Mac user it's automatically. In some cases for PC users, the port will change, and you need to check what port take each time you plug your USB port again. Okay, related with the IDE, it's very simple, it's empty. You have some few buttons. This here is to check the syntax of the firmware, and this is for upload the firmware to the board. Here you can see the serial monitor, which is a monitor who show us the information that Arduino are sending back to us, if we ask the Arduino to send back some information. Okay? And here, if you want to add other tabs to divide the entire firmware in different tabs in order to make it easier to use. And here is the status area in which the mistakes are shown, or for example, say the quantity of memory are you using. Then, in other words, you will write here the entire firmware, then you will check if the syntax of the firmware is okay, and then after this you can upload the firmware to the Arduino. If in the comments you ask to Arduino to send back some information. For example, show me the quantity of light are you receiving by for the sensor. At this point, you can open the serial monitor to see which is the numbers that the sensor or the Arduino sending back. Okay, then I think this is the most useful slide. Until here, it's clear for everybody.
Just a quick question: why there's 5-volt and 3-volt? When do you use one and the other?
Depending of the transducer you will use. For example, in some cases, some sensors use 3.3. But it's the sensor that you attach. It's the most common sensor. Actually, there are some Arduinos that work directly and only in 3.3 volt, because some sensors are mainly or only used in 3.3 volt. Then Arduino give us this possibility to give energy to those specific sensors. But normally Arduino work in 5 volt.
But so if I have a sensor that's 3 volts, I only power the 3 volt side, or I power both and Arduino powers the.
It depends on the circuit, but those two pins are power source. You can use it as you want.
Okay.
But our power source, let's say, directly without control.
They're input or output?
Output.
Oh, output power source. Okay.
There are power source continuously, 5 volt and 3.3 volt continuously.
Okay.
The other pin, the V-in pin, is to input. And then you can power supply Arduino from this pin. Okay.
Okay.
Everything is clear until here? Okay. Okay, then. I think this is very, very interesting synthesis because show us that Arduino is able to read information here in the world, the environment, to take decisions and to write or to talk to the world. Then I can digital read, I can read information digitally from on a specific pin, and the result that I will obtain from this pin should be or high or low. In other words, I can put, for example, a button. Okay. I can plug a push button from one pin. You can see here I already saw these three wires because I have positive, negative, and data. This circuit here, if I plug this circuit in the 5-volt ground and this in a pin, any let's say digital pin, then from 0 to 13, let's show you. For example, I plugged here in the pin number 8. Okay, then if I write a line in my code, we say digital read pin, and here I put an 8. The result that I read is high if I'm pushing, and it's low if nobody is pushing. Okay? In this way, I can read a button, read a digital input. Button is the most common example of digital input, but for example, it could be a tilt sensor, which is a tilt that when I till the sensor, a small conductive ball inside, move and close or open a circuit. Okay? And also in this case I will obtain a digital input. Then, if, just to close, if I write digital read 8, I will obtain or high or low. Okay. On the other side, if I put a, for example, this light sensor in the pin number A0, then this side here, A0. Then I write analog read A0, the result that I can obtain will be a number in between 0 and 1023. This is because the analog to digital converter will transform the voltage received for this pin in a number with this sensibility, okay, which is from 0 to 1023, which is, if I read 0, I have the maximum light that the sensor can read. Okay? If I receive 1023, I have the maximum darkness, for example. I'm just giving an example. It's better to, for example, use for this example on okay, this is a potentiometer, no? You know, potentiometer, it's a variable resistor. Then if I move the resistor until the end, the result read in this pin will be 0. If I move potentiometer to the other side, I will receive 1023. Okay, in the middle, I will receive a range of value of numbers. This is the difference between these two readings, analog or digital. Okay. At the same time, I can write the same things. Then, if I write digital, I can decide a pin to, for example, put a LED. Okay, I can plug a LED in my Arduino, and then if I write here, for example, I plug the LED in between the ground and the pin number 13. If I write here digital write 13 high, the LED will switch on. If I write digital write 13 low, the LED will switch off. Okay? At the same time, if I write an analog read, analog data, I can write analog write pin. In this case, we should choose the right pin, because not every pin could be used for analog simulation. I can put, for example, pin number 9. If you take a look of your Arduino, you will find the pin number 3, 5, 6, 9, 10, 11, and 13 that have this sign here. Okay? In those pins, you can simulate analog writing. And then you can put, for example, analog write 3, and the value is in between 0 and 255, right? Then if you put 0, then analog write 3, 0, the result will be in the pin number 0, the LED connected will be switched off because 0 is 0 volt. If you put analog write 3, 255, the result will be the LED switch on at the maximum value because 255 it means 5 volt. Okay? If you put analog write 3, 100, you will obtain the LED switch on, but not at the maximum value, but at 1/3 of the value, of the maximum value, okay, more or less. Okay, this is useful, for example, for mate fading, if you want to switch off and switch on very smooth. Okay, in the middle, there are all the functions of Arduino to decide the behavior of the Arduino in between input and output. Those functions here are, we will see after, but are more or less the typical function of any program. For example, if something is bigger than to something, if or for example, while the value is bigger than do something, or for example, for which is a cycle, for 20 cycles do this, okay, all the functions to control the behavior in between inputs and outputs. Then the extractor of the firmware. Very easy, has mainly three main parts. The first part is the declaration of the variables. It means if I inventing new words that outside of the normal language of Arduino, I need to teach to Arduino that those are variables. Then the second part is the setup of the board. Mainly it's been hey Arduino, from now your pin number 7 will be input and the pin number 6 will be output. Okay, this is part of the setup of the board. And then after you have the core of the program. What's happening here is that since the moment in which you power supply the Arduino, the microcontroller start to run and read these two parts just one time, and then after continue to look here until you switch off Arduino and take up the battery. Okay? Then, as I told you before, you can reset Arduino. It means if you are looping here, if you press reset, Arduino will interrupt everything and start again from here, read again the variables, the setup, and then continue to look here. Okay, this is important because if you want to do, for example, some beeper just one time when you switch on your robot. For example, you switch on your robot and you want to hear beep beep beep, for example, then you can put this command here, and then this will occur just one time when you start Arduino. Okay? You will see, you will hear here beep beep beep, and then until you reset Arduino and start again. Okay, the functions for the setup and for the loop are these two, and then all the instruction must be inside of these two keys. Normally, I ask to make the very basic example, which is the blink, to explain it, but I think probably you don't need to do it. But I will explain how to read this this firmware, also with this representation. Then, this is the firmware, and this is the representation of, in a, let's say, diagram, what's happening here. Then consider that these two slash are for comment all the line. Then all the parts you see in gray are not readable for the compiler, for the microcontroller. Then are only, let's say, human comments for programmers. This is what we ask you to comment the firmware you write, because when you start to write a firmware, if the firmware become very long, if you don't add this kind of comment, nothing, nobody is able to read the, to understand the firmware. Then the other possibility is to comment an interior paragraph, which is putting slash, asterisk, asterisk, slash, and then you can comment a few lines. And all the other parts are comment. Let's see the first line. The first line is int let equal to 13. Okay? Consider that these semicolons should must be at the end of each line, otherwise Arduino put together two lines and do not understand what happened. Then in each line here there is a closure with the semicolons. Okay. Then here we are creating a new variable, a new word, which is let. It's a kind of container, and it's a kind of container in which we assign the number 13. And then here we are defining what kind of variable. In this example, this is an integer variable, which is a container that can contain numbers in between 0 in between 0 and 32,000, right? 32,000?
Depends on...
Yes.
Depends on the data type.
Depends on?
On the data type, yes. 0 to 32.
It's, in any case, integer, I will find another example after, but integer variables can contain interior numbers, and okay, this is what we are doing here. We're creating a new variable. This is why we can find it here. In the second line, we set up Arduino telling that the pin number 13 is an output. Okay. If I didn't wrote this line here, when the compiler arrived until here, tell me, I don't know what is let, I don't know this word, okay? Because you don't define this new variable. Then, here we are saying to Arduino that the pin number 13 will be an output. Then Arduino will give energy from this pin. If I write pin mode number X, its input, Arduino will read from this pin. Okay? Then after this, we have the real program, which is, in this case, four lines. The first line is digital write 13 high. It means give 5 volts from the pin number 13. And then if I put a test or a multimeter here, I can read 5 volts. I can measure 5 volts from the pin number 13. And delay 1000, it's been stop any kind of process for 1000 milliseconds, which is 1 second. Okay? Then the result of these two lines is the pin number 13 will give 5 volt for a duration of 1 second. Then after, I'm telling to Arduino to take out the energy from the pin number 13, then switch off for a duration of 1 second again. Then after, finish and start again to the loop. Okay? In other words, the result of this is switch on, wait 1 second, switch off, wait 1 second, switch on, wait 1 second. Okay? And this is a blink, 1 second each. Okay, this is the very basic. Then, in order to input information from outside, we need to set up the pin, saying that a certain pin, that could be 0, 1, 2, 3, any kind of pin, of digital pin, will be input. Then we are setting Arduino saying that we will collect information from this pin. And then after, we need to create a container to save the data read by this pin. Then, for example, I want to measure the force that I apply in this sensor from the pin number 8. Then I plug here in the number 8. Then here I will write pin mode 8 input. Then I will create a container that could be named as you want, for example, force value without spaces. Then I will write analog read 8, and then each time the firmware will arrive there, Arduino will go to the pin number 8 and measure how much voltage is entering from this pin. And the value that could be in between 0 and 1023 will be saved, stored here in this container. Okay? The same thing for this, but in digital. And for the output, is exactly the same. First, I should declare that a certain pin will be an output. Then I will read this output each time I want to know if it's arriving some energy, some voltage from here or not, or in this case, how much energy. Then here we will have this is the output. Then when I decide that a certain pin will be an output, I will source energy from this pin, in this case maximum energy 5 volt, in this case a range of values in between 0 and 2055 quantity, let's say, of energy. This is the value. Actually, it was, as I said, the int. We can create different kind of variables. In the example, we use the int variable, I mean the typology of the container, and which is a container that can store as numbers, internal numbers, in between minus 32,000 to 32,000 positive. Or, for example, if you write unsigned int, you can receive values from 0 to 65,000, which is the same, but without the sign. Okay. Pay attention with this because each kind of variable consume a certain quantity of memory, and Arduino has at the end 32K byte. Okay, it's very small quantity of memory. Then, considering what kind of number you are planning to use, you can make your code in the best way. For example, in the example we showed here, we use a int type variable to store as a very small number. Then it's like to have a very big box to put inside a very small quantity of materials. Then the right way should, for example, use a variable to type byte. Byte can contain numbers in between 0 and 2,055. Okay? In this way, we will let's say save 1 byte of memory. Very common to measure sensor is to use floats, float number with a comma. Then it's more or less clear until here. Who is following me and who is for first time hearing these kind of things? You? No.
Abbiamo fatto qualcosa di C, quindi quello sì.
Okay. Ma che cosa hai detto
io?
Automazione. Okay. Then for the other people, it's already known things, this kind of things, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then I will be concentrated in you both. Okay. Then please stop me if it's not clear. Then there are many different commands, let's say, in the language of Arduino. As I explained before, the loop of the entire firmware of Arduino is a loop. Okay, then you have a list of commands, and Arduino will read all the commands until arrive at the end of the loop, and then we'll start again. Okay, then programming, it means how to make in some way loops inside the loops. It means do this until something happens, and then pass through and do this until something happens, and then do this and do this. Okay? Then how to organize different kind of loops internally to the big loop is in some way programming. Okay. Then for it's a way to create a small loop and internally to the big loop. How it work? You have this expression here, which is for, since a condition, initial condition, until this condition happen, with this expression, it will be more clear after. In this situation, if this situation is true, it's happened, then you do this. It means stay in this small loop until the same loop say you to go out. Okay? And then This is an example. You create a variable here, you can recognize int, which is a creation of a new variable. In this case, the variable is called I. This variable starts with a value of 0. And the condition, in order to do all this, is that I should be minus than 20. Then the condition is, if I is minus than 20, you will do this. But this time you pass from this line, I will be 1 plus. This expression here is the same to write I is equal to I plus 1. Then what's happening here is, in the first loop, I will be 0, which is minus than 20, and then we'll start to do this. This part here, you can recognize, is exactly the same of this, our blink. Okay? Then turn on the LED, wait 1 second, turn low the LED, wait 1 second, okay? Then, here is more or less the same. Switch on the pin 13, wait 1/4 of a second, because it's just 250 milliseconds time. And then the result of this is a blink more faster than the other example, because this time here. Okay? Then this is the same example before. But in this case, these instructions are inside of a for loop, which is, this will occur just 20 times, because each time I will pass here, I will be one more than the cycle before. Then first cycle will be 1, second cycle will be 2, 3, okay? Then in the cycle number 20, I will be 20, which is different than minus than 20, because 20 is not minus than 20, okay? And then in this case, the compiler didn't read all the content here and jump from here to here, okay? Then this is to explain how you can create a loop inside a big loop with a certain condition. Then do this until 20, then never enter again. Always. Okay? Guys, I think that I've not sense to make this, occupy all the room for 2 persons. Because otherwise you can't work. Then my advice is, you come here and we continue to explain one by one, or if somebody else wants to come, it's open, of course. But if I explain for everybody, 90% of the people don't pay care about this, but you can't talk and then you can't work. What do you think? It's okay, it's better?
Yes, I agree.
Yes.
Okay, then. Please come here and we will talk more.
I'm gonna watch the review. I'm going to watch the video.
Che non sono tanti, ci sono tanti modi per fare un livello, pochi modi per farli due.
Non
Okay. Where now we can.
I think we can have this presentation.
Yes. But I think it's easier to you and also to me to explain you directly, because we can also make some experiments and something. Then, if you agree, I will back some slides to take again the okay. Then, just here. And now we are talking about how to compose the firmware, the list of instructions to put inside of our Arduino. Okay. Then, the most important thing is the firmware has three main parts. The first part is when you will introduce new words to the language. If you don't introduce this word, Arduino will arrive to a new word and you can understand what are you trying to say, and it will give you some error. Okay. Okay. Then, in this part, you say, for example, I will create a container to save data inside. This is called a variable, and I will give the number of, for example, cookie. I don't know. You're inventing a new word, okay? And this part you will introduce here, saying, for example, cookie now have inside the value of 13. Then this is the content of the cookie variable, okay? And this is the typology of the variable. Then when I create a new content, a new container, I say which is the dimension of the container and which kind of content I will put inside, okay? And this
is
this is the typology of container. Okay. This is the typology of the container. This is the name of the container. And this is the content of the container. Okay? You can also create a container without any content at the moment.
Okay.
You say, okay, I will put in this container, I don't know, values of the sensor, but now I don't have any value to put inside. Just create the container. Okay? Then, this is why when I say control, and which is the right container for you, because each container, each typology of container, occupy different quantity of memory of Arduino. Okay? Then, for example, this is a container that can contain a number in between this that correspond a character of ASCII code. You know, each time you push a key, you are writing a number which is behind the key. Okay, each character of the keyboard is related with a code, a number. Okay, and this is the ASCII code. Then, for example, if you want to control your Arduino pushing keys for the keyboard, you will save the data that arrived from your keyboard in a char container, in a char variable, okay? This is, for example. Then now, for example, we are using int, that's typology of container. But the number that we are saving in this container is 13. And then it's a sort of mistake, because this kind of container can contain very large numbers. And I can use this kind of container, which is smaller, use minus memory, and it's enough to contain the number 13. for example. Okay? In any case, don't confuse too much about this. Consider just that you can create different kind of containers according with the content you will put inside. Okay? Then, this is an example in which you create a container, call it I, in which you put the content zero, okay, and then you say, okay, create a box, call it I, and put inside number zero. Each time the cycle occurs, I will increase one. Then in the first cycle, I will be one. In the second cycle, I will be two. In the third, okay? Then inside to the container I, if I see inside the container, I will see 0, 1, 2, 3, okay? This is why it's called variable, because the content is variable. You can continue to change the content. Okay. Then, this is another very important function inside of a firma, which is the if function. Then, how it works? If something is less than something else, or more than something else, or equal to something else, okay? You have two conditions here. In this example, you have a variable, then a container that could be, for example, I, or could be lead. You have a variable. If this variable, the content of this variable is minus the 500, then do this. And here you can write a lot of lines, okay? Otherwise, do this. And here you can write a lot of other variables. Then, for example, you can put a pressure force sensor, and then press the sensor and write. If the value of the sensor is more than X, then